I interjected just now when Mcebisi was saying that we must speak for 15 minutes. The reason for that is because I was telling the CEO of the Freedom Park, Ms. Mufamadi, sing Mafumadi, Mufamadi, that it's the first time when the CEO of the Thabo Mbeki Foundation spoke, that's the first time he explained to me what it is we're supposed to do here. So, now Mthabisi adds to this 15 minutes. But let me say about the Constitution. Obviously, this was the adoption of the Constitution was a very, very important day for those of us who'd come through the struggle. Because in the end, what this meant was that the South Africans would come together and signed a common national contract. It's a contract among all South Africans to say this is the South Africa that we want to build. An important day because at the end of a struggle that had gone on for centuries, here at last were we sitting down together as South Africans saying we agree to this. So this is a permanent construct. At the end of all the sacrifices and the deaths and the prison and exile and so on, at least now here, we've said this is the kind of South Africa we must build. I'm seeing a very, very important day for that reason. And indeed, I think that Mcebisi, one of the things that needs to happen, maybe let me make a bit of a confession. You know, we, those of us who sat in government for many years, as this Bahad is here, and I'm sure there are others, what practically happens, I'm glad to see Musi Maimane is here, so he might learn something. Sorry, Moose. I'm saying that part of what happens, you are sitting there in government, you are doing whatever must be done every day. And in a sense, that constitution gets into the background. It's at the back of your head somewhere. You don't ask the question that as we are preparing this law, what part of the Constitution does it address? As we are preparing this program, can we look at Chapter 5 of the Constitution to say, is it building the kind of South Africa that we want? You're conscious of it because you know that there's no law, no action that you can take which violates the Constitution and will remain on the statute book. But I'm saying in a practical sense, take, for instance, this challenge of, which is in the Constitution, of building a non-sexist society. I'm quite certain that if you looked at the programs of the government, certainly during the years that were in government, you would see, of course, all the interventions that were made to address this issue. But if you look deeper into this matter, for instance, if you look at this matter, the issue that is called gender mainstreaming, which in my view would be a critical intervention to make if you do indeed want to push forward this matter of the creation of a non-sexist South Africa. We never did it properly, that gender mainstreaming. And so I'm saying it's because as you do your practical work, the Constitution is sitting somewhere there. I think also so it's a matter I think that we need to push to the forefront to be able to measure continuously on a daily basis. If the Constitution said we must address the legacy of the past, to say, well, what is it, what are we putting in place in order to achieve that objective? If we're saying, as I was saying, we want to create a non-sexist society, what is it we're doing today which produces that non-sexist society? I think it's a very important thing to put on the agenda. I'm not certain, Mtabisi, you're part of the general public. Your familiarity with the Constitution. Because I think this is another one of our challenges. I suspect that a lot of our people, civil society like Zaki Yakub here, not him, but are not sufficiently familiar with what this Constitution says. And part of the consequence of that is that indeed I will sit in government and do something that is wrong, that is even unconstitutional. Sure, Musmai Mane will stand up in parliament and saying this is unconstitutional, which is correct thing to do, and the judges will also intervene, which is the correct thing to do. But where is the rest of society in this? I think if it was better familiarity with what the Constitution says, then you would have this bigger social intervention in defense of the Constitution, and therefore against whatever it is that is negative that is being done. I'm saying it's a very important point because this, as I was saying at the beginning, this is a national contract. We all of us agreed, let's draft this Constitution. What shall it say? It says we must build a non-racial South Africa, we must build a non-sexist South Africa. We must respect the sacrifices that were made in the past to bring us our freedom. We must do this, government must function like this, the courts like this, and all of this. Here is a Bill of Rights. The Bill of Rights says the following things. This must become part of what is owned by all of us, because this is the kind of South Africa we've all agreed that we must build. So I'm saying that that's another challenge I think that faces us with regard to this. But certainly, I think for everybody who was involved in the struggle for the liberation of South Africa, I think there's a special responsibility that falls on the shoulders of those ones. Because in the end, indeed, when the Constitution says South Africa belongs to all who live in it, black and white. So we all say, viva. Because this is a statement that came out of the liberation movement exactly in those words. And now it's in our national constitution. So here's that vision for which many people sacrifice their lives. It must not be something that we remember on a Sunday afternoon when we visit Freedom Park, but become a daily document that helps us to act to build this kind of South Africa which the Constitution spells out. And that's what I think might save us from wrong things that governments do, including presidents. Thanks. The first question, I'm sure, was not intended to be answered. Excuse me. But you know, I think what is clear to all of us is there's a lot of restlessness in the country. A lot of disaffection about the situation. I think quite understandably. You know, all of these things that Akona was talking about here, maybe the complaint about transformative or non-transformative constitutions, levels of poverty, of unemployment, young people who can't afford, or families can't afford to send children to university. Lots and lots of problems. I would say to the current leadership, that's the first thing they've got to understand. I don't know if you saw, maybe you didn't, a report in the Eastern Province Herald of a speech given by a member of the NEC, of the ANC, Mbeki, who spoke in Port Elizabeth on May Day. And that article says the May Day rally was organized at a stadium, Dan Kretler Stadium. But an hour or so after the rally should have started, there were only 9 people in the stadium. An hour later, a few more. So the organizers decided to move the rally out of the stadium into a hall. So it moved into a hall. And then the report says, the hall is in, there's a ground floor and there is a balcony. The balcony was empty. The ground floor was half full, which means the hall was a quarter full. And that was the May Day rally in Port Elizabeth. So Mbeki Cele was one of the speakers there. And Mbeki says, what we see in front of us here in Port Elizabeth tells us that we are in trouble. And he said, look, it's maybe, it's something which you should not have said. He says, maybe you can tell lies to other people, which you should not have said. But he said, but let's not lie to ourselves, which you should have said. Because he says, this tells the truth. The people are disaffected. The people don't want us. He says, these rallies don't work. We must now go to door to door to talk to people. I agreed with Mbeki. I read the article and he wasn't there, but I applauded him. I gave him a standing ovation. Because I think that is the first thing that any leadership needs to do. Not to tell lies to itself, but to understand what is the situation in the country, what are the challenges, and indeed, why were we elected? You go to parliament, you say, I'm a representative of the people. You've got to demonstrate it by what you do, by the responses you make to these problems that are facing the people. So that's what I would say to the leadership, the advice I would give, really, to concretely understand what is happening in the country. You will know that a number of foundations here, the Tutu Foundation, Adelaide and Oliver Tambo, Thabo Mbeki, Robert Sobukwe, Albert Lutuli, and all of these ones, Jake Schavel, they came together and their discussion, as I understand it, the CEO would explain this better, look at the country to say, look, there are many, many problems. There are problems that relate to the politics and governance in the country. There are problems that relate to the economy. There are problems about social cohesion and national cohesion. There are even problems of morality. Lots and lots of these problems, and everybody in the country today is discussing these things. What is the future of South Africa? Whether you go to urban areas or rural areas, black, white, everywhere you go, people are discussing this thing. Where is our country going? So these foundations come together and they say, look, why don't we have a national dialogue as South Africans? Instead of talking in corners and under tables and so on, let's come out into the open and talk critically, make an assessment of where we are in order for all of us to be able to say what is it that we need to do. And I think that's a correct thing to do. That's a correct suggestion to make. And I think that engagement among our people, given the situation in our country today, that engagement is very important. My advice again, therefore, to that leadership really would be that, look, they must encourage that. I must say that when President Zuma addressed the ANC rally on January 8th this year, he actually said that. He said it's necessary to have a national dialogue to confront the issues that divide us and address them and reinforce the things that unite us. And those are more or less his words. So let's have this national dialogue. Because I think it's also important that the people must speak. The people that you people report in the newspapers are the leaders. What about us who are not leaders? When is our voice going to be heard? So it's very important that the people must speak and not just you have a dozen or 12 or 20. I recognize the UDM and the DAU are here. I respect them. They must be allowed to speak, but also we must be allowed to speak. That's what the national dialogue must do. And this leadership, I think, needs to understand that. We would have to discuss this thing about a constitution that's not transformative and a judiciary that's not transformative. You'd have to explain that and to say what does it mean. Because indeed, I think as Mtevisi was saying, quoting a judge, Dekang Mseneke, first of all, I think we must recognize, as again Mtevisi was saying, this constitution, like all other constitutions, will be a product of its time. You are sitting in South Africa in 1996, 94, 95, 96. You are coming out of these years of colonialism and apartheid. It's very close. We don't know where South Africa is quite. We are not quite sure where it's going. Even this thing, Angela Jones talks about her acceptance of the change. But at that time, certainly in the leadership, we were very, very concerned that you would have a residue of people in white South Africa who would not have accepted change, who would want to resist and make sure that certain things don't happen. And we're saying that it's very important that we carry people together. We carry the country forward. Maybe I should tell you a story about this. Mtevisi, tell me when to stop. We prepared for the negotiations here in the late 80s. Drafted a document in Lusaka, and then went to, the first country we visited was Tanzania, to show the Tanzanian leadership. You say, look, this is what we are discussing, this document, which talks about negotiations that are coming. We know for a fact that there are going to be negotiations. We've got to prepare. So this document said something. It visualized negotiations, holding of elections, in drafting of a constitution. So Julius Nyerere, he looks at the document and he says, this thing of yours about electing a constitutional assembly which negotiates a constitution. How are the kaburu, the Swahili say kaburu, the Boers, why do you think they are going to accept this? No, but Mwalimu, this is, you see, that's the transformative stuff. This is what we want. So Nyerere says, you see, we must recognize reality. The reality is that you, ANC, have not defeated that regime. And that regime has not defeated you either. Now, what you are suggesting here is you're going to go to South Africa, negotiate, hold an election, and then write a constitution, because the ANC will win those elections. And then you'll sit there and write this constitution yourselves without the other people. He can't accept that. So, all right, okay, Mwalim, what do you think we should do? So he says, you see what you do. In the negotiations, you must agree on constitutional principles. And that's negotiated between you and the Boers. These are the constitutional principles, a democratic South Africa, a non-racial South Africa, all of these things. And those constitution, those principles, must then be binding on the constitutional assembly that will be elected, in which you will be the majority. That way, this thing will work. So we agreed. And that's exactly how we proceeded. This was understanding of reality. Mwalimu Julius Nyerere understood the balance of power in the country. When he said, you have not won, you haven't defeated them, they haven't defeated you. So you need, that's the context, that's an objective situation in which you have to operate. So I'm saying that the constitution was drafted in those conditions. The situation obviously has changed. But I think one would have to say what it is that is blocking transformation in the constitution. It's not obvious, it's not self-evident. Again, as was said, even on the land question, let me tell you another nice story. I'm about to sit down. I've got a good story to tell. You know, there's in these last few days, there's a report in the media about Malmesbury in the Western Cape. There's a farmer there who abandons a farm because the soil has got exhausted and so on, and it would take too much money to put in fertilizer and so on. So he lets it to lie fallow. And he runs another farm where he's keeping cattle and sheep and so on. So five Africans, they approach him. They buy a cattle. They buy a cow from him. They were going to slaughter it. And they learn about this farm, which is lying fallow. And they talk to him, and he tells them that this farm is, the land is bad. So I really have to leave it there, and well, I'll see about it tomorrow. So they say to him, but can we use it? So he says, but I told you, the soil is exhausted, you can't. So they insist, they say no. Then he says, okay, you can use it, but he makes a bet with them that you're going to fail. Yeah. So they take the farm, and they've been announced the South African Farmer of the Year in the Western Cape. It's five Africans. And to show the pictures, the vegetables have grown. And they say the trick was to use manure. So they went and collected the manure from the farmer and from his cattle and did it instead of chemical fertilizer. And the farm is thriving. Now, that's a good story to tell. Yeah. Because it's Africans. But it's Zimbabweans. That's a very interesting thing about it. It's Zimbabweans. It's not any South African who went to the farmer to say, can I use your farm? But the Zimbabweans did. Because Zimbabweans have got a very different attitude to land. That's why you find here many, many times, you get the land settlements, people make land claims. They get the land. Instead, they say, no, rather than take the land, give us money. So I'm saying that even when we talk about the land issue, one has got to understand this thing quite seriously. Very, very seriously, very objectively, to say, what is the nature of the issue? Isn't urban land the more urgent issue in the country? It may very well be, rather than agricultural land. But one needs to look at this thing and not just make slogans. Now, the last thing, Davis. No, you see, the when we adopted the, well, on the eve of the adoption of the Constitution, I mean, it occurred to me that the, you know, you, constitutions are not adopted every day. So we're adopting this constitution and it'll remain for generations. So it's a history, it's a critically important moment. And therefore, you can't make a normal speech. The speech has got to be abnormal in that sense. Or more than normal. So that's what, but what do we say? But of course, as I was saying earlier, this is a great achievement for people coming out of the liberation struggle. It's our product. It's a product of our sacrifices. And it's something that we can put on our shoulders and walk around in the world without any sense of shame or anything, that this is a great product. It comes from us Africans. But once you say African, then the issue of identity comes up. So it became quite clear that really this is a moment that all of us Africans, in the way I spoke about of Africans, then the sun and the whites and the Indians and Chinese, and that you know, this was a moment for us to rally around this commonly agreed document to define ourselves as Africans and really to make the assertion. To make the assertion in the face of the Afro-pessimism and all of that, to make the assertion that as Africans, these South African Africans and the rest of the continent, that as these Africans, we are actually capable of miraculous things. That this Afro-pessimism, this notion that the Africans are doomed to fail is wrong. And we're not saying that just in words, we've got this product. And challenge everybody, say, can somebody show us anything better? No, they can't. And this one comes from the Africans. And who are the Africans? It's all of us. I think the bulk of the questions that were asked have been answered. I agree with my colleagues here on the panel in terms of the responses they've given. Justice Zaki Yakubi responded to this matter about corruption. Of course, it's a critical challenge. It's a critical challenge that we must address. But indeed, as he was saying, there are all of these other challenges, rates of murder, rape, and so on. But it is one of these critically important issues which indeed needs to be addressed. It is very important, very critical. I'm very glad the issue of the banning of schools was raised. Now, I'm quite sure, I don't know, the lawyers here might say, and Zach, I'm sure it's illegal. It's illegal to ban schools. It's illegal to go and ban libraries and ban trains and all of this banning that takes place. I don't think it requires any new law. The law needs to be enforced. But this is a very, very difficult issue, a challenging issue. We're talking about this matter with Emusi Maimane before we came here. It's a very deeply worrying thing. Because it's this particular incident that we're talking about, the recent one, where 25 schools have been burnt in Vuani and so on, it signifies a certain collapse, a collapse of order, and disrespect for society generally. Where you can have people who will deliberately go out to burn schools because of municipal boundaries. And you've got thousands and thousands of children who are not going to be able to access education because of this. It says something extremely negative about what is happening in society. And my fear is that it reflects a tendency which might be towards a replication of that kind of action throughout the country. A state of anarchy in society. And I think it requires police action to act against this, let these people be arrested and so on. But there's another matter that we need to address. There is something that is going wrong with the society which produces this kind of action. And if we don't address that thing which produces this kind of action, I'm afraid that you might get this thing replicated elsewhere. But it is an urgent thing. And it was very unfortunate that there are some statements coming from that region, from some of the leadership in the region, who were more or less excusing, giving some explanation for this kind of criminal action which was taken in terms of banning of those schools. But it's a challenge that I think we need to address. I agree with the matter that Zaki Yakube, his response about this thing about people using the past to stay in power, indeed is very, very correct. If we forget that past, which is part of our problem, I think part of the issue that's raised about mentoring, it relates also to that. If we forget that past, that many things will go wrong. I don't think it's so much the past that keeps people in power, it's other things. so which we might want to address. So the constitution, of course, the constitution must change. Even the current constitution, the constitution of 1996, I can't remember how many amendments there are already to that constitution. Zach might remember. 17 amendments already to the 1996 constitution. So it has not stood still. There's no constitution that will stand still. So the point that is made that it will change, of course it will change. Of course, the situation today, in 2016, is not the same as it was in 1996. That's not the same, doesn't feel the same. But I think if I was asked to make a speech on this occasion, write a speech and so on, I would repeat the things I said in 1996. Because those things are correct. To say this constitution, the things that Zach again was talking about, this constitution has helped us to address this demon of apartheid, which is a good thing. It has said, look, there must be equality among the people of South Africa, which is a good thing. It must said there must be a non-sexist South Africa. It's a good thing. I would repeat those things and say we're very, very proud of these things which this constitution says. And I would still say this remains a product of African hands. African, that inclusive African. And I would still say I'm quite convinced that whatever our problems today, tomorrow will be better. And I don't think there'd be any need to change any of those messages. I don't think we should be, we should despair because the situation is difficult, as it might be today compared to what it was in 1996. Because I think the values, again, as Zach has been saying, they remain. What is reflected in that Bill of Rights remains as correct today as it was 20 years ago. And we must continue to do what has been suggested with regard to that. I understand the issue that was raised about, which Akona raised, discussed, how can we claim its Africanness without transformation? But I think that raises an important question. You see, maybe more than one question. The fact of the matter is that we're 20 years, 22 years old, 22 years from 1994 now, and remain with many challenges in the country. And we're going to remain with these challenges for quite some time. Because again, I come back to what I was saying earlier. I think it is critically important to understand South African reality and to understand the global context in which South Africa operates. Late last year, there were reports. One of them came from the Bureau of Economic Research at the University of Stellenbosch and then to somewhere else. And they were saying a business in South Africa is not investing in the economy. That there are huge billions of cash that are kept in the banks. And the reason, and they were saying in those reports, the critical reason is that business community is uncertain about the future of South Africa because of the politics. So you have what might look like an investment strike. Not investing, because unsure about where is this country going. Now, you see, so you can say, well, I can say today, look, in 2 years' time, why don't we invest so much in this economy and reduce unemployment by 50%? Sure, it's a lovely dream, but will it happen? Will the resources be there? Will these investors that you need to create these jobs, will the atmosphere have changed? What do you do to intervene now to reassure them, to say, you investors, please invest because everything is okay? But I'm saying it requires to understand the challenge of transformation in the country. It requires serious understanding. I was very serious, for instance, about talking about the land issue. The land issue. If you look at the record of the land claims that have been settled over the last 22 years, 20 years, whatever, you will find that in the majority of cases, the people who win the claim, they prefer to take the money rather than keep the land and work the land. That's the reality of South Africa. The point I was talking about, a good story to tell with the Zimbabweans, is because really, genuinely, objectively, the Zimbabweans have got a very, very different attitude towards land from what our people have. So I wasn't at all surprised to read the story that in Malmesbury in the Western Cape, you got 5 Zimbabweans. Incidentally, I should have said this, all of them are university graduates in mathematics, in physics, in sciences. They're teaching at schools there, and they do the farming over weekends. I've got 10 rand in my pocket. That's the only money I have. I can bet anybody they produce for me one black South African graduate in maths who's farming. This is the objective reality of our country. You can look at other things. Here, I shouldn't go too far with this. Look at who is working in construction, in construction industry in South Africa. I'm talking about the black people. It'll tell you a story. Let me not go further. Now, the point I'm making about the transformation issue is I think we need to understand our reality. Plus, then we need to engage. We engage the struggle for transformation ourselves. And not to sort of we delegate it to somebody else who's going to do this transformation for me, I will. But what do we all of us do to change this very deeply entrenched, unequal society? The South Africa we inherited in 1994 had been constructed over 350 years. And that construction was very bad. Even look at the question about education. Bantu education system was introduced and has produced destructive results which we still suffer from today. Once I was a chancellor of a teacher training college in Mpumalanga, and we graduated students there. 98% of the students passed with a distinction in biblical studies. One sociology, one in accountancy, 98% biblical studies, distinctions. So I said to the principal, we can't have this. I like the Bible, but it's not going to take us, you know, we need engineers to take us to the moon, but... So the principal said... I was deputy president then. He said, deputy president, I understand. I agree with you. But the problem we have is that these young people who are graduating now with distinctions in biblical studies are a product of earlier teachers who qualified here with distinctions in biblical studies. They are reproducing themselves. That's a product of Bantu education. We are living with it today. The transformation, I'm saying the transformation challenge is all in our hands. We need to grapple with it, understanding that it's not going to, we are not going to solve these problems overnight. I agree about the mentoring. The mentoring, of course, I think needs to take place. I think what Zach was talking about, when talking about the University of KwaZulu-Natal and WITS, it was that kind of thing. Thabo Mbeki Foundation and UNISA, they do this leadership training thing. We need more and more of that kind of mentoring, I agree. And indeed, with regard to the gender issue, again, I would like us to come at this thing as practically as possible. Historically, when we grew up, maybe situation has changed. Where you didn't have piped water in the villages, it was women who fetched water in buckets. You put it on bucket on the head. I understand in some areas of our country that also it would be women who would fetch firewood. So you want to take that burden off the shoulders of the women. So you say, let us make water available in all the villages and let's make electricity available. immediately you impact positively on the status of women in society. So they no longer have to be running to the river and all of that. I'm saying I want to be very practical about all this, to say we need gender equality. We don't want to continue this discrimination against women, that women are lesser beings than the men. So you need to say, I was talking about gender mainstreaming, because I was, we're discussing this thing at the University of Venda a few months ago. And you see, you find, for instance, that if you look at the teaching staff at our universities generally, majority are men, white men. The minority are women, both black and white women. And part of the reason produced in the studies, the universities themselves have studied this report. They say because this thing that was mentioned of making women men, that what is happening in the universities, that they don't take into account the fact that women get pregnant and they have to raise babies. So when the woman is doing all of that, got to give birth and look after this child for some time, the university deducts that period in terms of the possibility for a promotion, for instance. Why? Why are you punishing a mother for being a mother? But that's what's happening at the universities. So, for instance, one of these vice chancellors was saying that he went to university in the United States and walks down a passage and finds on the door, written on the door, lactation room. And he was very surprised. What is a lactation room? So he asked. And they explained to him that, you see, we've got women who are teaching here, we've got babies. Rather than them taking 4 hours, take 2 hours to drive home, 2 hours back, bring the child here. So as a university, you prepare a proper lactation room, very private, and all of that, in order to take into account the fact that these are women. You don't want to manize them. Was that the word? But in order to achieve the gender equality, you must therefore discount, as it were, this fact, so that you don't say this woman was away from work for 3 months because she was bringing up a child, and therefore it must impact negatively on the possibilities for promotion, which is what is happening. As a result of which, you will then find that there are very, very few women professors, but the women in universities are in the lower levels. It would not have happened if we had engaged in the gender mainstreaming. So I think we need to, the matter of the empowerment of women and gender equality is very important. Again, not in any way to suggest that women must become men. And there are particular challenges around that, including this issue of mentoring. Certainly, in the political sphere, there are many times when you've got to mentor both men and women. Musi Maimane here will confirm this. Where you say there must be 50-50 representation in terms of candidates for an election, and you go to a constituency, and the outcome of the election is not 50-50. It might be 70 men, 30 women, because the electors have not understood this matter of the struggle for gender equality. So they produce that result. In our country, we're fortunate that we have this proportional representation system. Can manage it. But I'm saying that I believe that we need to come at this thing in as practical a manner as possible. I'm finished now with all of these questions, but in the end, I think we have correctly met here to celebrate the 20th anniversary of the adoption of our Constitution. And I think the fact that we meet constitutes a commitment to do some of these things that we've spoken about. Really, let's see what is it that we need to do among ourselves, among our friends, wherever we may be, indeed to understand that Bill of Rights in the manner that Zach Jacob has been saying. To understand it, to internalize it, to do whatever. Because all of these things that relate to the Constitution are about the empowerment of the people to determine their destiny. If we say, here is an instrument that we have in our hands, a very, very powerful instrument, whatever its limitations, a very, very powerful instrument, we are going to use it to create this kind of South Africa that is spelled out here in this Constitution. I think if we do that, coming out of this celebration of the 20th anniversary, we come out of this with that kind of commitment, I think it would make a great difference in terms of our country, in terms of the way the country is run, the country is governed, and give hope. Give hope that whatever the problems today, we will indeed have a better tomorrow. But thanks a lot.